Hello guys, welcome back to Tesca Technologies Private Limited. My name is Shivam Vijay and today in this video I am going to giving a basic demo on electropneumatic trainer. In this trainer we will be studying about the basic electropneumatic components, how they are worked. We will be also do some basic exercises for incorporating the electropneumatic components. Also we will be study about the why electropneumatic circuits are required in the industry, whether there are already pneumatic components are available. So as we know, pneumatics plays a very important role in the complete industry processes, whether this is finishing, this is pulling, pushing, or there are a lot of processes in the industry which depends on the pneumatic. So pneumatic is essential, but working with the pneumatics is become complex when we talk about the very complex design of machinery, whether they are working and logic circuitry through the machineries are dependent only on the basic pneumatic circuits. For example, if we suppose in a machinery there is a signal required to a very far place from the machinery, or the machinery has a very long distance for working the complete system, so the signal from the any roller level actuator type of pneumatic circuit is dependent on the orifice of the pipe, length of the PU tubing, orifice of the complete setup or orifice of the wall, and what how much time the complete air and pressure requires to reach the exact directional control valve in the basic pneumatic circuit. So the dependency becomes the only on the pressure and air supply ultimately, and this becomes the more complex and slower response for the machinery purpose. So to resolving this type of problems and issues and to create the faster response in the production process, engineers built up the electropneumatic circuits for the complete process. In the electropneumatic circuits, some of the walls and some of the circuits, apart from the basic pneumatic working, basic pneumatic circuits required for operating the complete force and processes, but the signal process and the controlling process will build up on the electropneumatically circuits. Electropneumatic operated valves are introduced with the relays and push button, which are the basic automized and basic fast working components than the air supplied components. So for actuating the components, we will use and we are starts using the electrically operated components. So in this video, we will be also observing the electropneumatic components which are operated with the electrical signals. We will also study about the relays, how relays are used, push buttons are used to actuate any of the cycle of electropneumatic working. So we'll now move on to the complete description of all the components in this trainer, and later on we will do some exercises as well. So here now you are seeing the closer look of electropneumatic trainer. The order code is 52106A. You can use this order code to find out the specification about the complete trainer setup and what you can learn from this complete setup by visiting our website, which is www.tescaglobal.com. So now I will explain you about all the components one by one. So we'll start with this double acting cylinder. This is a double acting cylinder which works on the double operation and double actuating circles. In the first, here you can see there is a wall inlet or the air inlet supply hole with the PU fitting is connected over here. Similar is also at the forward end. So when we provide air supply from this end, there is a piston inside the cylinder which will start pushing when the air inside starts filling. So it will start pushing the piston on forward direction and the piston moves in forward. Similarly, when we provide supply on the front end of this cylinder, so again air starts filling inside the cylinder and piston again move backwards from the air pressure or air force. So the reverse movement will achieved. So the complete cylinder works on about the 10 bar of the pressure. It can work from starts from 2 bar, at least 2 bar of pressure is required to operating forward and backward movement of this, and up to 10 bar it can work. So this has about 100 mm of stroke complete, and we can achieve any of the process or operation which are can be performed in the 100 mm of stroke length. Then we have a single acting cylinder. This has a single acting cylinder. This is a spring return type single acting cylinder. So when we provide air from this back end or rear end of the cylinder, it will start moving forward when the air inside the cylinder starts filling, and it go to its complete length till the piston reaches at the front end. On the same condition, when air is removed from the back end, there is a spring inside the piston which will pull back the piston or the rod so that we can achieve the reverse cycle automatically. So this works on the spring return force. Then we have flow control valves over here. Two flow control valves for the double acting cylinder, one flow control valve for the single acting cylinder. Both the valves are provided. These valves are required to control the flow of air supplied to the inlet and outlet of both the cylinders. So when we control the flow of cylinder, the pressure will be controlled, and ultimately we will control the speed of the cylinder for moving forward and backward. So that's why we can control the flow. Similarly, apparently we will also control the speed of the cylinder for movement. Then we have a directional control valve. This direction control valve works on the electric circuit and electrical signals for actuating. So this is a 5x2 solenoid operated electro directional control valve. So why we are saying this 5x2? Because it has 5 ports. These are 1, 2, 3, 4 and 5 ports over here. So these 5 ports are the complete design of the cylinder. Out of them, 2 ports are required for the operation. So that's why we called it 5x2 electronically operated solenoid valve. Now you are getting the closer look of this 5x2 solenoid valve. So this is a basic diagram by which we can understand the working of this 5x2 solenoid valve. Over here you can see there are 5 ports described with the numbers already. So this is a circuit or signal diagram of the directional control valve, how it is working. So there are 5, 1 and 3. There are 3 ports on the lower side, and 4 and 2 are the upper ports of the lower side of this complete cylinder. Then there are some arrow or direction are also provided. Here you can see the one number or the middle port, this one is connected with the pressure line. So there is pressure line will be connected on this port over here. These two are the exhaust line for both the circuits, and these are the A and B, we can say 4 and 2 of the line for the output. So these are the two output that can be worked for operating and actuating any of the cylinder. Here what happens, this is the solenoid valve signals. When the coil is actuated of the left right side, the pressure port or one number port will be directly open to the two number port. So supply will directly going through the two number port, and we can achieve the cycle where the output of this port is connected. So if we connect this on the backward side or the forward side, the forward or backward side respectively will be going on. Similarly, when this left side of the solenoid coil is actuated, the pressure port will connect it to the 4 number port, and the pressure line will be directly going from the 4 number port. So we can actuate the required operation for this. Similarly, at the same time, when the pressure port is connected with the 4 number port, the 2 number port will be connected with the exhaust over here. So this exhaust will start exhausting the air already filled inside the cylinder for operating. So it will easy to move forward. And similarly, when P port is connected with the 2 number port, at the same time 4 number port will be connected with the exhaust line over here. These are the arrow symbol which are describing the same. So here when pressure line is provided from the 2-number port so that outlet line from releasing the pressure will be connected with the 4th-number port and the pressure or the air inside the cylinder will be exhausted from this exhaust port. So that is how the pneumatic cylinder or pneumatic directional control valve works with the solenoid supply. There is also a mechanical plug provided for checking the supply is properly or not, so that when the solenoid coil is damaged, you can check this with whether there is no harm inside the cylinder, and this will operate with both the type of actuators provided on the top end. The solenoid coil generally works. There is a plunger inside the cylinder for blocking the ports on the desired location, or we can say there is a spool inside. So when the coil is energized, there is a plunger inside the coil, or which is covered from all around the coil. So when we provide supply to the solenoid coil, this will create a magnetism or the magnet inside the coil. This starts pulling the plunger. Plunger is a metallic object, so plunger will pull through the coil, and spools are open, already designed, are created so that when it's pulled from the left side, the port P will be open, the 1-number port will be open to the 4th-number port and 2-number port, and 4th-number port will be open to the exhaust line. Similar vice versa action will be happen when we energize the left side coil. So that is how we operate with the electronic circuit for creating the electro-pneumatic component, electro-pneumatic circuits. Now this is the 3x2 solenoid operated valve. This is a spring return type of solenoid operated valve. Over here you can see at the symbol, the one side is at the solenoid symbol and other side is describing the spring symbol. So this is a spring return solenoid valve. It just operates when we provide the supply on the coil. This will pulse the plunger and operate as the pressure port or the 1-number port will be open to the 3-number port over here. 2-number port over here. And when we remove the supply from the plunger, it will exhaust the pressure line directly from the exhaust over here. So there are total 3 ports. Out of them, 2 are used. So this is 3x2 solenoid valve. Now moving on to other components. This is the lubricator, FRL unit, the filter, lubricator and regulator unit, in which filter inside the symbol are connected so that air is filtered from the impurities on the atmospheric impurities. Then there is a regulator over here. Just pull it up and you can regulate the air supply or air pressure from this. And lubricator is also provided so that there will be some amount of air lubrication, so air will be easily to operate, and oil, some amount of oil and lubrication will be provided to all the valves to move in the proper condition without any rusting and hesitation with the damaging or finishing with the movement of mechanical movement of inside spools and openings. Also, main incoming from the air supply and compressor will be connected over here so that it will filter out the moisture content of the air supply or compressor, generated compressed air, so that from the output when we take it in the electro-pneumatic circuits, so that air will be properly filtered and workable and usable, so that there will be no harm to the components from any of the moisture content for rusting and any other hazardous things. Then we have slide valve with junction box, or we can say manifold. There are 3 outlets of this manifold are provided, and this is a slide valve over here. So output from the FRL unit will be connected directly to this manifold and junction, so that we can provide different supplies to different components on the complete circuit. This is a slide valve. When we pull this on the left side, this will be block the complete supply, and the direction says when we turn this to the right side, this will start providing supply to the manifold or the junction box. Junction box are designed as when there is no connection on the upper side of this valve, this will be in no working output whether you are on and off the complete slide valve. When you connect any of the supply to this PU fittings, this will start giving supply towards the output. So this is designed like that. Now moving on to the push button and relay block. In this there are four push buttons are provided. These are the NO type of push button with momentary push button. So circuitry and designs are also provided on this push button. So in this block, these are the 0 volt and 20 volt, 24 volt are indicated. We require 24 volt supply for operating all the components in the electromagnetic circuits. So we'll provide supply from here, and you can extend the supply from these terminals. Both are connected inside internally. And this is a single operation switch over here for the NC operation. In the NO operation, this will be the normally open condition. When we press the switch, this will be NC will be going to NO and NO will be going to NC, so that we can create the operation and logic for desired value. Similarly, on the NC switch, this will be in normally closed condition. So when we connect the normally closed condition, this will going open, and normally open condition will be going normally closed. But this is a stop operated switch, so there will be condition change for when we operate the switch permanently. Then we have the relay block over here. There are three relays are provided. All of them are connected and operated with the 24 volt supply. These are the coil points of the relay. So when we provide supply on these points, line and neutral from both, or the 24 volt and ground to this, the relay will be operated. Here NO points will be changes to NC, and NC point will be changed to NO. These are the common points of this, and these are the common points of the relay, and the 44, 34, 24 and 14, the lower one, are the NC points which are normally connected, and 44 and the rest of the upper components are the NO. These are the normally open terminals. So when the relay is actuated, these goes to NC in the normally closed condition, and these four go close to normally open condition. So that is how relay works. We will study it while practical, and complete operation will be also performed with the relay. Now we will discuss about the magnetic switch over here, which is connected on both sides of the cylinder. Here you can see this is the magnetic switches which are connected on both sides of the cylinder. Now we will study about this, how this works. This is a basically transistor based NPN on PNP type of magnetic switches. So what happens when we provide supply to the ground and black terminal which are connected with the wire on this. This is a three terminal device. So this creates an energized condition inside the circuit, and when the piston position reaches to the just behind on the cylinder or the magnetic switch, this will pulls and generates the magnetism inside the magnetic switch, and the output will be occur on the blue one. So this is how the magnetic switch works. Similar action is required for sensing the position of the cylinder. So we use the sensors for this. Some of time we can use the proximity type of sensors as well, but for the mechanical adjustment, or basically generally in the pneumatic cycles, only magnetic type of switches are used with three terminal devices. So we will also see the working of them as well with the exercises. Now this is a 24 volt power supply. For this is generally a switch mode power supply. So when we provide AC power to this complete device, this will generate the 24 volt power supply working as an SMPS. Generally the 24 volt at 4 amperes will be generated at these terminals. This is a symbol for turning on and off the supply, and this is fused with the 4 ampere switch, and this is a power on off button for this supply. So which is required to control all the relays, coils of the solenoid valves, and magnetic sensor in the complete setup. So we'll also working with this. And for the accessories and for the connections, we are offering PU tubes of about 15 length and about a half of meter of 8 mm PU tubes, and rest of the 15 mm PU tubes for easy fitting of all the components is about 15 meter. So you can do your connections with the pneumatic circuits as given in the user manual. Also a tube cutter is also provided and some T fittings and a spanner for tightening up the magnetic sensors to different position are also provided. Then we have patch cords for doing up the electrical circuit connections for this. So we'll do all the exercises in two steps. First we will do the pneumatic circuit, then later we will do the electrical circuit for the same, so by which we can operate the complete components electrically with providing the signals. And this is a patch cord, sorry, the power cord also provided for power on the SMPS supply. This can be connected on the back side of this power supply, and the user manual with complete details about the electro-pneumatic components, working of the components with detailed descriptions are provided in this user manual. So you can study this properly to get the complete explanation and knowledge about electro-pneumatic components. Exercises, circuits are also given in this, so we'll follow them and do the practical on the complete trainer. Now we start doing the exercises given in the user manual. The first exercise is about operation of double acting cylinder using double solenoid valve, in which we will use separate manual controls for forward stroke and return or reverse stroke. So this is the pneumatic circuit over here presented in the user manual. We will build the pneumatic circuit in which all the components like FRL unit, slide valve with manifold is connected with the double solenoid valve. The two solenoids S1 and S2 are provided, so we'll provide supply, and then the pneumatic line will be connected using flow control valves, and forward and reverse operation of double acting cylinder will be achieved. For this we require the electrical signals also, so we require two push button from the push button section, and this will be connected with the 24 volt supply for operating the solenoid valves. So we'll do this while building up the both circuits, electrical and pneumatic relay ladder on the trainer board. So first we will provide the input supply to the FRL unit with the compressor line, and we'll connect the output to the junction manifold. This will remain same for all the exercises, and then we do remaining rest of the pneumatic connections, then we do the electrical connections with the help of patch cords, and we'll perform the operation. So firstly, this is the incoming line from the compressor that need to be connected on the input side of this FRL unit. Then we use the same 8 mm PU tube of the provided half a meter. This will be connected on the output of this FRL unit. These are the push fitting type of fitting, so you just need to press and push it the pneumatic tube or the PU tube so that it will be easily plug in. Here you can see if I pull it, it will not pull because it gripped from the inside. But if you want to pull it, just push the PU fitting downwards and it will release the PU tube. So don't pull it over so that you will damage the PU fitting. Just carefully put inside to build up the connections. So this is the basic connection, will remain same for all the exercises. Just now I will start the pump or the valve of the compressor, and there will be pressure inside the pressure gauge. So I will turn on the pump. Pressure line. Here you can see now pressure is shown in the pressure gauge. So it is completely blocked. We need to increase it. So here, just move this in clockwise direction and your pressure will start increasing. So we required about 2.5 to 3 or about 3 bar pressure on the pressure gauge. The black line is of the bar in the unit and the red lines are in the PSI. So we required about 40 to 50 PSI pressure for for 3 bars in the bar unit. And as you set the pressure, if you want to decrease the pressure, turn this knob in anti-clockwise direction. And if you want to increase the pressure, turn this in clockwise direction. Here, the pressure is decreasing like this. And to increase it, just turn this to in clockwise direction and press it down to lock it properly. So this will now not able to move. So we have set our pressure. The manifold is connected. Now we do the rest of the connection. First we will do the pneumatic connection, then we do the electrical connection. Now for pneumatic connection, we will just use the 4 mm PU tubes. You can cut them in your desired size. I have cut some of the sample tubes for this. You will get the proper sample without cutting. So you can use this as per your desired size. So we are using the double solenoid valve. So connect one end the PU tube in the inlet of manifold so that the power supply will be continuously on over here. I will also show you how. If I turn on the slide valve over here, the supply output will be provided. And if we remove the PU tube from the manifold, there will be no output supply. So it will only work when we connect the PU tube inside. So this is how the manifold works and design. Now we will connect the other end to the pressure port or the inlet port of the double solenoid valve. Now from the outputs of the solenoid valve, we will connect the fourth number port to the flow control valve first, and in continuation flow control valve output will be connected with the rear end of pneumatic cylinder. And similarly, output of this flow control valve, the solenoid valve will be connected with the flow control valve over here. And output of this flow control valve will be connected with the forward end of pneumatic cylinder. So this is the basic pneumatic circuit that has been completed. Now we do the electrical circuit to operate the solenoid valve. Now for electrical connections, first we have to power on the SMPS supply. For this, we will just connect a power cord which is provided with the complete setup to the 220 volt AC socket, and other end will be connected to the power supply. And when we turn it on, here we can see this is 24 volt DC showing right now in on condition. So we will use two patch cords from here and provide them to the input for 0 to 20 volt on the push button section. First turn it off, the gel light will be goes off in some time. So we'll connect ground to the ground one, positive to the positive, and again we can turn it on. Now for the solenoid valve connections, we will using the coil supply wire which are provided with the solenoid valves already. So we require to provide 24 volt supply to the solenoid coil to be operated. So these are the two wires, black one and red one. So red one will be provided on the 24 volt and black one will be connected to ground supply. So for this, we will provide ground from ground, and the positive one will be provided from the push button cycle. I will also explain it in the electrical circuit. So as per the electrical circuit, we can see one end of the push button will be connected with the 24 volt supply. So we will provide 24 volt supply to any of the push button. Two push buttons are required for both the operation, forward and reverse. Then second end of the push button from the NO, of course, the normally open terminal will be going to the positive of the solenoid valve supply, and the negative black one of the solenoid valve will be going to the ground. So we'll do the same as described in this circuit. For this, we'll use a red patch coat from the 24 volt power supply. This will be provided on the NO. This is the normally open terminal over here. So we'll provide it on the 13 number terminal. Similarly, for the second operation, the 24 volt supply using this patch coat will be provided on the 13 number terminal of the second push button. Here, now output will be going to the solenoid valve from the second end of the push button. So for this, we will use the direct wire of the solenoid valve, so that positive of the solenoid valve supply or solenoid coil supply, we can say, is going to the 14 number terminal. When we push the push button, they both will be connected. So 24 volt supply will be directly provided on the coil, and ground will be provided from the ground supply. So you can connect the ground over here, or here you can also connect it. So both are internally grounded. Similarly, for the second solenoid valve, we'll do the same. 24 volt supply will be connected, or the phase or the positive of the coil will be connected with the positive supply, and ground will be connected to the ground terminal. So we can connect both the ground included. Now we are ready to operate the cylinder. So now we are ready to operate the cylinder using the push button. For this, we just first need to turn on the slide valve over here. So slide valve is on, pressure slightly drop on the pressure gauge here. Pressure is distributed amongst all the components right now. Now when we press the push button, first we achieve the forward cycle, and when we press the push button second, we achieve the reverse cycle. Here you can also observe there is a slight LED glows up when I press the push button. So it indicates that the power supply is provided to the coils. Again, I will explain you forward cycle and reverse movement. Forward movement, reverse movement with both the push button. So that's how we can control the movement of any machinery with push buttons with the electrical signal. So this is how electro-pneumatic components works. Now we move on to the next exercise. So now for the second exercise. In this exercise, we will be study the operation of double acting cylinder using double solenoid valve. Forward stroke should be manual and return stroke should be automatic as it reaches the forward end. For this, we will use the magnetic sensor for the same here described in the diagram over here. A1 is the forward magnetic sensor. So we'll use this, connect this with the complete supply. This is the pneumatic circuit. The pneumatic circuit will remain same as per the last practical. Just we need to change the electrical signal. For the same pneumatic circuit, we can do the electrical signal with some little modification of sensors for sensing the forward and backward position. So we'll do the electrical signals and electrical circuit as described. Similarly, for the push button, we have to provide the one end of push button to 24 volt supply, and the other end will be connected with the solenoid valve coil, and the other end or the solenoid coil's second end will be connected to the 0 volt supply. Similarly, for the next step, we will connect the brown wire for the positive of the 24 volt supply. Black wire will be connected with the relay over here. We will use the relay also for this, and from the relay one end for the coil will be connected with the sensors terminal, and other end of the relay will be going to 0 volt, and output of the sensor, the blue wire will be going to the ground also. So output is black, which will operate the relay similarly, and other end of the relay will already connected to ground. So when the sensor is actuated, output is provided, and output across 24 volt will be going to the relay for actuating this. So on the relay from the NO terminal, we will operate the solenoid valve 2. So this will operate the reverse cycle of the forward acting or double acting cylinder. So we'll do these connections and see how it works on the electrical signal and the complete tenor board. For this, pneumatic cycles or pneumatic circuit will remain same. So I do not have removed the pneumatic circuit, just we need to change the electrical circuit. So we will do working on the electrical circuit for this. For this, we will again build up the first connection for the positive supply. The positive supply will be connected with the 13 number terminal, as we provided the 24 volt at the 13 number terminal. So when we touch the push button, the output will be provided on the 14 number terminal. So over here, we will connect the forward supply solenoid valve 1 here, as described in the picture or in the circuit of the pneumatic cycle. We will consider solenoid valve 1 over here for the forward movement, and we will consider the solenoid valve 2 for the reverse movement. So this need to be specified for working like this. For this, the 24 volt of this solenoid valve 1 will be connected with the phase or the 24 volt supply with the NO button, and this will be going to the ground. Now first line of the relay ladder is completed. Now we'll use the A1 magnetic sensor. For this, we need to use this 3 terminal sensor. So we need to connect the ground with the 24 volt supply. So we use it on the 24 volt supply directly for providing and energizing the magnetic sensor. Ground will be connected with the ground supply. So we'll connect this to the ground supply over here. And as the sensor senses the piston behind that, so black is the output, and blue will be going to the ground, and output, which is black, will be connected with the relay. So we'll use the relay 3 over here. So phase is provided to the relay here, and ground will be provided directly from the ground. So we'll use a patch cord to providing the ground over here. And now from the NO terminal, we need to provide 24 volt supply to the relay. So 24 volt supply will be provided. You can just extend the supply using 2 patch cords to these terminals. Both terminals will be now energized, internally connected with the 24 volt supply. I am directly using the 24 volt supply from the lower push button block over here. So 24 volt supply will be provided to the common terminal of the relay, and at the NO, which is the 14 number terminal over here, we will use the solenoid valve. So this is the wires of solenoid valve 2. So we'll connect the solenoid valve 2 at the 14 number terminal, and the second end will be connected to the ground as well. So this is the electrical connection that has been done. Verify your connection with the circuit once before turning on, and if you get the operation not proper, again test and check your connections and do the proper connection for this. Now for verifying our output, after verifying the complete circuit, we just need to turn on the slide valve, and when you press the push button over here, this will provide supply to the first solenoid coil, and as the forward movement begins and piston reaches the forward, and this will, the sensor, magnetic sensor, will sense the piston position that it is now in forward condition, and immediately provide signal to the relay for operating the second solenoid valve, and we will achieve the reverse movement. So we'll press the push button over here. Here you can see immediately as the piston reaches forward, this will provide the reverse signal and reverse movement achieved. If you are able to see a slight blink on the sensor also, so that you can get that the sensor is sensing the forward piston position and it's giving the output to the relay. So let us take a closer look to see the slight blink on the magnetic cylinder. So as the cylinder reaches forward movement, the magnetic sensor senses the position that piston is at the forward end and immediately send the signals to be relay to be actuated. Now similar at the same time we will also observe the flow controlling. The flow control valve will block the air supply and reduce the air supply to the cylinder. This will control the speed as well. Here you can see the speed is slightly down from the earlier. If I close it some more, here you can observe the forward movement is slightly slower, so that you can easily achieve the flow forward movement. And similarly, if I reduce the flow from the reverse end or the front end, so that the front supply or the front pressure supply will also block and we can achieve the slower movement for both front and backwards. Here you can see both the cycles now slow down. So you can change it to the required pressure. It's slightly more closed. So that's how you can control the speed of both the cylinders of working using the flow control valves. So this is the important part of flow control valves that is also explained in this video. Now we move to the next exercise in which we will see the multiple cycle operation of the double acting cylinder. Now for the next exercise in which we will see the continuous operation of double acting cylinder using double solenoid valve. In this we will use the both sensors provided on the front or back end of the double acting cylinder, in which the pneumatic circuit diagram is same from all the cycles. Just in this also we need to do modification in the electrical circuit for that. So electrical circuits is given over here. So we require the PB4, which is the continuously operated PB. So we'll use this continuous switch, so that continuous supply to the sensor A0, which is considered to be the back sensor of the double acting cylinder, will be used. Similarly, 24 volt supply from PB4 will continuously provided from the anode terminal to the brown wire of the magnetic sensor A0, and the black wire will be actuate the relay 1 over here. So we'll provide the output on the relay coil 1, and other end of the relay coil will be connected with the 0 volt supply, and blue of the sensor of the blue wire will be connected also on the 0 volt supply, so that it energizes the A0 sensor. Then the other 24 volt supply will be connected to the anode terminal of relay 1, and thus other end the common will be connected with the relay, and from the anode terminal we will actuate the solenoid valve S1. So this will be operate the solenoid valve S1. So when the sensor A0 sends, the solenoid valve operates with the relay. And similarly A1, which is operated when the cylinder's forward movement achieved, so this will operate. So we'll already provide supply from 24 volt on the brown terminal, and ground will be blue will be connected with the ground. So this will operate the relay 2. So relay 2 will operate the anode from as the relay switch change mechanically, so that the anode will be go to NC. So from the anode we will provide the supply to the solenoid valve 2. So at the same time solenoid valve 2 will be actuate when the relay 2 actuate. So what happens when the forward action achieved. A1 sensor operates. This will operate the relay 2, and relay 2 actuates the solenoid 2. So as the solenoid 2 actuates, the reverse cycle again achieved, and as we continuously provided supply from this push button to the A0 sensor, so when the reverse movement achieved and again cylinder senses the A0 senses the piston of the cylinder behind this, so it will again actuate the relay 1, and relay 1 actuated the solenoid valve 1, and again we achieved the forward movement. So that's how continuous operation of forward and backward will be achieved. So we'll do the all electrical connection on the trainer board, and we achieve the multiple operation of double acting. So here, as we required the multiple operation and more than one relay on this circuit, so I am using the extending for the push button block to the relay block. For this, just connect black with the 0 and 24 volt using the red patch cords. So we have extended both, so here we can easily provide supplies to all the components. Now we'll start working with the push button 4 over here. This push button is required for this, so we'll connect 24 volt supply first to the 13 number terminal. So when we press and stick the push button, so this will continuously provide a supply to the 14 number terminal. So at the 14 number terminal, we have to connect the sensor A0. So we'll use the A0 sensor's wire over here, and the positive will be connected to 24 volt supply. Sorry, the positive will be connected here to the 14 number pin, so that supply will be continuously provided from this push button, and ground will be connected to the ground, and the output of this sensor will actuate the relay 1. So we'll connect this to relay 1. Also, we need to provide the ground on the relay as well. So we'll provide ground from the 0 volt over here. Both are connected in series under internally. Now we'll provide the 24 volt supply to the NO terminal of the relay 1, or we can provide the 24 volt supply to the common terminal of relay, which is 11th number terminal, and from here we will operate the solenoid valve 1. So wires of the solenoid valve 1 will be connected. So we'll connect red with the 14 number, and 0 volt will be provided through the ground. Now for the next operation, we will now provide supply to the A1 sensor for this. So we just need to connect it to the 24 volt supply, and output will be operate the relay 2. So for 24 volt supply providing it, we'll just using it to the 24 volt supply. You can use 24 volt supply from anywhere else. So sensor is connected, positive and negative of the sensor is connected to 24 volt supply, and output will be actuated the relay 2. Over here, ground also need to provided from the ground terminal. So we have provided the ground to the relay as well. And over here, we have to provide the S2 solenoid valve 2. So 24 volt will be connected from the 24 volt terminal to the 11 number common terminal of the relay, and NO will be connected with the solenoid valve 2 supplies. So we have connected the 24 volt or the positive of the coil, and ground will be connected to any of the ground provided on the signals. So these are the electrical connections that has been done right now, and properly verify your connection before experimenting. And if you find the process is not proper as described, so again check the connections. There will be and there must be an error in the connections. Now for operation, we first turn on the power supply of the 24 volt, and we will turn on the slide valve, and we just need to press the PB over here. This will be continuously operate the cycle, and the multiple and continuous operation of forward and reverse will be achieved. So now we'll press this. Here you can see the continuous operation of forward and reverse is continuously achieving. Over here you can also see both the signals from the sensors are also providing. There is a slight blink on both the sensors. So when cylinder or the piston reaches forward, this will give you the blink, and when the cylinder reaches reverse, this will again give you the blink over here. So I am just adjusting the speed so that you can easily observe the forward and reverse cycle from both the sensors. So you can also continuously operate at different speeds. Suppose there will be some operation going on in a machinery process and you required to adjust the speed as well, and forward and reverse continuous operation of a cycle is required. So this is the basic sample for pneumatic, electro-pneumatic example of the components. And once your practical done, you will achieve the both continuous operation. To remove this continuous operation, you just release the push button that we have continuously provided. So as I release this, this will stop the continuous operating of this double acting cylinder. Now we will see a problem or a situation in industrial product line which is given with this statement. This is for the example and for external learning on the pneumatic trainer, electro-pneumatic trainer. For this, its problem statement says, on manually giving an electrical input to cylinder A should extend forward completely, thereby pushing the component for a machine operation. Then after machining is done, cylinder B pushes the component for the processing in next stage. Then cylinder B should return to its initial position, which is retracted position, followed by cylinder A. The illustration of the application is shown in the figure. In this figure, we are seeing that first cylinder is pushing the object to be drilled, and the second cylinder it pushing the object after drilling is completed. So there will be an output inside this. So we required two cylinder with two double acting cylinder with double solenoid coil for this complete operation. The circuit or electrical circuit is also given in the user manual. Both the lines are given, but we have over here only a single acting cylinder and a double acting cylinder. So we'll modify this circuit according to the single acting operation, in which we just use a operation. Drilling will not be happen over here. The double acting cylinder will push the forward the component, and the single acting cylinder push the forward to the 90 degree other direction for moving it. So this will, you can resemble that the object is coming from the production line, and just we need to change the direction of the product for the other stage to be processed. For this, two cylinders are working. First is pushing it to the X direction, and second will push it to the Y direction, and the continuous operation for all the objects will be going on. So we will do this exercise with the knowledge to be extended on the electro-pneumatic trainer with the single acting cylinder and a double acting cylinder. Now for this, we required both the cylinders, the double acting cylinder and the single acting cylinder, for this production line to be explained on this complete trainer board. We also required 3x2 single solenoid valve, which is a spring return solenoid valve, to be operated with the single acting cylinder. Now we'll do the pneumatic connections. Double acting cylinder pneumatic connection will remain same as per the all practical that we are working, and for the single acting cylinder we will be do some amendment in this complete circuit. For this, we'll just use the manifold from the other end of the manifold, one end also extend, and this will be connected to the inlet port or the one number port of the 3x2 solenoid valve, and the other port or the output port will be connected with the flow control valve over here for the single acting cylinder. And this output will be connected with the single acting cylinder's rear end, so that you will also get the component to be used from the single acting cylinder. So we required both the sensors of the double acting cylinder and front end sensors of the single acting cylinder as well for this circuitry. Now the pneumatic connections has completed. Now we will do the electrical connections for the same condition. Now for pneumatic operation of these cylinders, we need to provide some electrical connections for this. We will start from the basic connections of power supply. So first, power supply positive and negative will be coming to the junction board over here. Then we will extend the power supply to the upper junction box as well. You can provide it from here as well. So I am not finding any black patch code, so I am using the red one instead. Now we first do the first stage of this ladder diagram. For this we will use the continuous operating switch. 24 volt supply will be provided on this switch. As we operate this continuous operation, the continuous supply will be provided to the sensor A0. This is the A0 sensor recalling for this cycle, A0, A1 and B1. So we'll provide the supply to this. So when we provide operation of on or from this push button, this will actuate the sensor, and as the double acting cylinder will be remain on the retracted position or the reverse position, this will operate the sensor because the piston right behind the sensor. So this will operate the sensor and we will get the signal to operate an actuator relay. Blue need to be provided on ground and black will be the output. Now we'll provide ground to this relay. For grounding, we will connect this to the any ground, and from here we will operate the solenoid valve 1. So we will provide 24 volt to the common terminal of this relay, and the solenoid valve 1 will be operated from here. So we will connect it to the anode terminal and ground will be provided from any of the ground terminal. Now this is the first step. Now for the second step, as the cylinder moves forward because it senses and operates the solenoid valve 1, and cylinder reaches the forward movement. So when the forward movement achieved, we will get the signal from the sensor A1. We are calling this A1, A0, A1 and B1. So we required the sensor to be operated, for we provided already supply to this. So 24 volt positive and negative will be provided over here, and as the sensor operates, we'll operate a relay from that. So we'll connect the output of the sensor to the relay for actuation and provide a ground to the other end of this relay too. And from here we will operate the single acting cylinder. So we will operate the valve or the solenoid coil of the single acting cylinder from the sensor position A1. So first we will provide the 24 volt supply to the anode terminal. So this one is the anode terminal, and these are the wires of solenoid coil S3. So we'll connect this over here and ground will be provided to any of the ground socket. Now as the supply is provided to the coil S3, this will operate and extend the forward movement from this cylinder. The single acting cylinder will go forward, and as it reaches forward, its sensor B1 will be also operated. So we'll use this sensor B1 to actuate another relay, and from that relay we will actuate the solenoid coil 2, which will pulls back the double acting cylinder. So this will the cycle that we will going to do. So we need to continuously provide supply to this sensor as well. So connect positive and negative to this sensor, and we will operate the relay 3 over here from the output of this sensor. Now provide ground also to that, and from here we have to provide the 24 volt supply to this as well. For providing 24 volt supply, I'm using it from here and connecting it to the 11th number pin. From here we will operate the solenoid valve S2, which is the retracting, which provides the retracting action for the double acting cylinder. So solenoid valve coil will be connected over here. So this is our connection. So as the solenoid valve connected and removes and goes back, the cylinder, the sensor will also de-energize, and this will remove the supply from the relay 2, and relay 2 will deactuate, and deactuating will be remove supply from the S3. So similarly, as the supply removed from the S3 solenoid coil 3, the single 3x2 solenoid valve, it is a spring return valve. So the port will be closed automatically with the spring force, and the cylinder 1 will be also retracted. Now we will verify the connection again and we'll start working on this. Now for realizing the operation, we now provide air supply from the slide valve over here and turn on the SMPS supply as well. So 24 volt supply is also provided right now. Now as I press the switch S1, we'll get the double cycle operation of both the cylinder. So that is how we are achieving both the cycle operation for this. Now we can adjust the speed also for this operation. So what's going on, we can also understand this. For forward cylinder, I will also decrease some flow. So according to the production speed, we can adjust both the flows of cylinder movements. So what's happening here, if we resemble the problem, the block comes over here from the front cylinder and it extend it to the other conveyor line, and from sending it to the other conveyor line, the second cylinder retracts and it sends this to the second conveyor line. So that is how the pneumatic operation works without any manual operation, and continuous operation will be working when the continuous product are coming in the conveyor or the production line. So that is how we can use the multiple cycle operation from both the cylinders. Speed can be also adjusted according to the flow. Now if you want to increase the speed, just release both the valves. You can adjust all the speeds or all the functioning according to the requirement. So that is how we work with all the components on this trainer board. And if you want to stop the complete cycle, just press the stop button and your cycles and continuous operation of multiple cylinder operation will be stopped. And whenever you want to again start this, just remain this connection, press it again and it will start working continuously. So that is how we perform the multiple cycle operation with this complete trainer board. There are lot of circuitry, lot of operations and problems that you can perform on this and get knowledge about working of different logic circuits with this complete logic and electronumeric component circuit. So the last example of the basic production line with the two cylinders working is just for explanation and to describe the capability of the complete tenor board, how far you can do and learn from the different logic circuits over here. This might not included in the user manuals for the practice exercise, but you can do it from the video as we described in this video. And if you want the paper diagram or the circuit diagram on paper with the soft copies or on the in hard copies, this will be provided on demand. Here our demonstration of electronumatic component trainer is now completed. You can do all the experiments, exercises as I described in this video. Also, you can reuse the user manual, refer the user manual, all the detailed information and knowledge are provided for different type of electronumatic components, how you can use them. Study it properly and work on the trainer board, you will get to knowledge and benefit of working of electronumatic components. Also, if you still find difficulties while working with this kit, you can contact to Tesca Technologies Private Limited for all type of supports. And if you like this video and the content of video you find useful for you and you get some knowledge about the electronumatic working, electronumatics in the industry, you can share this video to your friends, colleagues and fellows for getting the knowledge and spreading the knowledge about the electronumatic working. Also, press the like button so that it will motivate us to provide the good content for your knowledge. You can also subscribe our channel, which is Tesca Tech on YouTube. There are a lot of videos with different type of practical information with the different type of educational trainer kits are uploaded. So you can get the knowledge of different working of different concepts as well from the Tesca Tech YouTube. Also, don't forget to press the bell button so whenever we upload our new video for your knowledge, you can get the notification about that as well. Till then, thank you for watching this video and we will meet in the next video very soon.